As you see, we have a very, I want to talk about a lot of things today, basically going from the starting point of the theory of interactive fermions to some very recent topics of recent research. So you have to be very disciplined, but you don't have to. You can ask any question during the talk. Last time we have described how one can design an interaction between two point-like non-relativistic particles, that would be non-perturbative and at the same time point-like, local in space. What we were saying is that what we would do is that we would get, we would force these two particles to interact with the centrally symmetric potential. So let's recall we are in three spatial dimensions. In three spatial dimensions, we can fine-tune the depth of the potential and the width of the potential so that there is a one bound state exactly with zero energy. One can think about that as by saying that although the interaction is concentrated in very small region in space, when the two particles interact, they still feel the influence of each other at very long distances. The distance that these two particle fields, the influence of each other is, roughly speaking, the inverse of the square root of the energy of the bound state, which is here taken to be infinity, while the real potential is very short distance. Let us now go to describe how the system can be understood in various points of view. Sometimes it is useful to step back from quantum field theory and think about the quantum mechanics of the problem. In this particular case, the quantum mechanics is actually very the quantum mechanics point of view is very useful. Instead of considering two particles, let me right away jump into a more general case. Suppose I have a spin 1/2 particle so that the spin can be pointing upward or downward. The wave functions can be written for general n-body state is a function of the position of the particles. And I'm going to separate the position of spin up and spin down particles. So this will be spin down, and these particles will have spin pointing upward. Fermi statistics tell us that the wave function has to be anti-symmetric when I exchange x with an x, another x, or y with another y, but there is no constraint at all if I exchange x and y. Let us now take one particle, say with x1, and let it approach y1. That is, I'm trying to look at the wave functions when the one particle will spin up and one particle will spin down approach each other. All other particles are far away. And then they will interact through this potential. They can be in the relative S wave, and they will feel this contact potential. So we can think about the Schrodinger equations for the wave function. Let me ignore all the coordinates except for the relative coordinate between the two particles. So I have r squared r is the x1 minus y1, okay, plus all the other terms, including all the derivatives, say equal to e times psi. And the reason why I don't have to think about these other Laplacian square or even the energy, that is because this gradient of r square will be dominant if r goes to zero. Right? When r goes to zero, this is 1 over r, and this dominates over other terms. So the equations, the Schrodinger equation now, is simply the Poisson equation. The Poisson equation, as we know, has two solutions. two solutions if we require that the solution is centrally symmetric. Namely, it can be a constant, or B over R. If we are talking about the Schrodinger equation for free particle without any interactions, usually one put a boundary condition that the wave function is non-singular when two coordinates coincide. But from the mathematical point of view, nothing forbids you to require that the Schrodinger equation, that the boundary condition at R goes to zero should be, for example, B over R. There are two different choices. Actually, there is the usual choice, and there is the choice where we require that the wave function is just 1 over R. And there are a continuum of different choices in between. Okay, this is just a mathematical fact. Now let's think about the physics. What does it mean for us to say that the wave function has to be half like B over R? Yes, that's because we are going to the small r limit when this term is proportional to 1 over r squared, roughly speaking, and this term is of order 1, so one requires that this term, different components of this Laplacian square should cancel each other, and that's why we are solving the Poisson equation. What is 1 over r squared? This grad of psi squared. Dimensional analysis. Gradient of r brings down one power of r.
But there's the scale of the potential, right?
There is a scale in the potential. I'm pretending there is no potential. Actually, I'm going to explain to you what happened here. We are taking the size of the potential to zero, and we are looking at the solution to the equation outside the potential. So that's why I say this goes to zero. Actually, I mean that it is still outside the range of the potential.
Yeah.
And now, if you look at the quantum mechanics of this potential, you will find that that the solution to the Schrodinger equation is typically it is some function. It is you have to match the boundary condition. Usually, you solve the equation here. And then you match that to this a plus b over r here. Okay, and at low energies, the relative ratio between these two coefficients is called the scattering length. At low energy scattering, one gets the scattering length by solving just the Schrodinger equations at zero energy, and then write this is equal to 1 over r minus 1 over a, where a is by convention is called the scattering length. It is the dimension full parameter that characterizes the interaction between particles at very low energy. So you want to think about this way. And there are two special values of the scattering length. When the scattering length is equal to zero, this term dominates over this term. It's infinite, and that corresponds to the choice of the boundary condition that we make in the case of the free particles. Free particles interact with zero scattering length. So A equals zero corresponds to free particle. And A equals infinity, and that one disappears, correspond to the case which is called fermions particles, or in general particles, but the most interesting case is fermions at unitarity. Infinite scattering length correspond to the resonance at zero energy. A resonance at zero energy happens when you have a bulk state at zero energy. So this is the easy problem you can solve for the Hamiltonian. Yes.
So wasn't called unitarity.
Unitarity fermions came the name. the name comes from the following fact. If you compute the scattering amplitude between two fermions, then the S wave part of the scattering amplitude saturates the unitarity bound. That's why this is called fermions at unitarity. Now, yes? Froissart bound is a completely different thing. This is in the theory of strong interaction. This is just, there is a, from optical theorem, you can derive the unitarity bound for each wave, each partial wave in the scattering amplitude. And in this regime, when A equal to infinity, R naught goes to zero, and A goes to infinity, the only interaction you have is the S wave interaction, and it saturates unitarity. And for a Froissart bound, you have to sum up all different partial waves. No, it doesn't have to do with the Froissart bound at all. Now, it's completely S wave, so it's S wave scattering amplitude saturate the unitarity. That's the name. Now thinking about usually one in quantum mechanics, usually we have the we formulate Hamiltonian, that is kinetic energy plus potential energy. But here, in this particular limit, we don't have to think about the potential energy at all. We can formulate the problem as the problem of a Hamiltonian that is a sum of a free Hamiltonian with minus sign here, plus the boundary condition on the wave function, namely psi, this psi x sine x, all this x y, in the limit when x I go to y j, has to be equal asymptotically to some function of other x and y divided by x I minus y j absolute value plus zero plus something of order x I minus y j plus etc. The requirement here is that the wave functions near the two, when the two points start to go to each other, we have singularly the regular term goes to zero, and all the other term is determined from the solution to the equation. You can see a very interesting similarity between this two different boundary conditions with the thing you do in the ESCFT for the scalar field when the dimension is within the VF bound and VF bound plus one. There you also have the freedom to choose what kind of boundary condition you put here.
This is a boundary condition for unitarity.
At unitarity. At unitarity, yes. At unitarity you have this. And you can see that
X is for the
and Y's for spin down particles? Yeah, X are all coordinates of spin up particles and Y's are coordinates of spin down particles. When the two particles with the same spin approach each other, the wave functions should vanish because of the Pauli principle. So nothing there, we do nothing about that. The problem as formulated here is very simple, but as you can see, cannot be solved exactly except for very special cases. For example, when you have few particles, or when you have, only for the small, there are small number of cases where the problem can be solved. So before proceeding, let me tell you where this situation can be realized in nature. So first of all, there is a, if you look at the scattering length between two neutrons, turn out to be numerically large, minus 20 Fermi, which is bigger, somewhat bigger than the range of the interaction the range of the interaction can be estimated as the inverse of the pion mass, and that is a Fermi. Actually, the range of interaction is about 2 Fermi. Okay. So with the reasonably good accuracy, if you have if you have two neutrons at in a range of energy, one can think about these two neutrons as interacting through a fine-tuned potential. A proton and a neutron form a bound state, a neutron with a very low binding energy. A two neutron almost form bound state.
What does
minus sign means that they don't form a bound state. If the plus sign is plus, then they would start to form a bound state. Infinity, plus or minus infinity, correspond to the intermediate case when they have a bound state at zero energy. Another case, fine-tuning that is unexplained and presumably unrelated to the anthropic principle is the scattering length between two helium atoms. You think about helium, usually if you learn chemistry, helium is the inert gas that doesn't form any molecules. But actually, if you take two helium atoms, they form a very weakly, very shallow bound state. The potential between two helium atoms, helium-4, has the minimum. The minimum. That one is about I don't know its exact number. The order of magnitude is about 10 Kelvin, and the bound state happens at 1 millikelvin in a very fine-tuned system, which is a fine-tuning that just happened. These are bosons. The previous case concerned the fermions, and the third situation where it is realized is in cold atoms. In traps, and this is done in various laboratories around the world, including here at Chile. So I will not explain how this is done. Tell by word. There is a technique called the Feshbach resonance when you tune the magnetic field, and you can fine tune the interaction strength between two atoms. And you can fine-tune the magnetic field so that the scattering length is infinite. Now,
do you know the consequence of this shallow bond state for helium-4 atoms for like superfluidity? I mean, is that something?
If you put three helium, they form a much tighter bound state with the energy about 100. Millikelvin. So you keep adding to the cluster more and more atoms, and at some point they form a droplet with the binding energy of minus seven Fermi per atom. So it's a continuous transition between that and the microscopic superfluid. Yeah. With two particles, they are just in some S wave bound state. Suppose. You can also look at the algebra using the fact that D and K is equal minus IK, and then use the Bianchi identity and prove this thing.
What is the way to understand in terms of Galilean transformation?
I don't think in these terms. Yeah, it's rather mathematical, and here it has to be at zero, so the dimension the operator has to be evaluated at zero, and one can check, for example, that if I take psi of x and commute with the Galilean boost y, that would be k and psi, you will find something like integral dy. And then y delta x minus y psi of x, that is equal to 0. So the operator psi, for example, is an operator that is primary. But for example, if we take the derivative of psi, that is no longer a primary operator. So. Convergent.
Yeah, in an ordinary CFT, there's an operator product.
That question has not been investigated. I hope that after this lecture, people will go and investigate questions like that. Okay. Okay. Yeah, question? Okay, so the primary operator is defined. From one primary operator, I can build up a tower, actually a diverging tower, because I have two raising operator, H and P, and can construct derivative with respect to space and time, and then get other operators. There is now an interesting correspondence. We remember in relativistic CFT, we can put in a dimension of operator into correspondence with the eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian of the theory on the sphere. There is something similar here. If we take the and this fact has been found in a quantum mechanical form by Kastein and Werner and also Shinatan in the form that we are discussing here. The claim is the following: if we take the Hamiltonian that I will call H-OSC oscillator, that is H plus omega squared c. Okay, and you can see why it is called a harmonic oscillator, because c is x squared. Adding a c x squared to time n to the Hamiltonian means that we put the whole system in harmonic potential. There is a correspondence between the eigenvalues. So I will write here eigenvalues of that with dimension of operator. Each operators in this quantum field theory, each primary operator, dimension of if you have a primary operator and we need the primary operator, well, let's restrict ourselves to primary operator that contains only, say, an annihilation operator, but do not contain any creation operator. This operator, the dimension of operator, maps into the eigenvalues of the system in harmonic potential. And you can read the proof of this statement in our paper with Nishida that I wrote now here. I will just illustrate that on the examples of the two operators that we have seen. First, we have the operator psi. That has dimension 3/2. The eigenvalues of a single particle in harmonic potential is 3/2 h bar omega. As we see previously, the dimension of operator phi is 2. And we have solved these Schrodinger equations in a harmonic potential. The wave function is written here. The energy is 2 times h bar omega. So there is a matching between the dimension of primary operators and the energy of a system of few particles in harmonic potential. Can be done. That can be seen.
So there are infinite primary.
Sorry? There is an infinite number of primary operators, but there is only one operator which has particle number 1, psi. There is an infinite number of operators with 3, say, constructing psi, it would be infinite number of these. Now, last 5 minutes. On the top, I will.
Non-primary operators have
a dimension that is basically the dimension of some operator plus an integer.
So there's no
There are a state, but the correspondence is the state in harmonic harmonic potential is also organized into ladder, and there is actually a map between the ladder operators between two sides.
Does the degeneracy of the oscillation
model correspond to the degeneracy? The state that corresponds to operators has to annihilate a certain certain operators. So it should be annihilated by certain operators. So if you have degeneracy between states that are annihilated by that operator, that I don't have time to write it down here, then you have degeneracy in the operator dimension.
Is it like the usual conformal group where each primary operator can distribute some irreducible representation, and then the non-primary ones are just filling out the rest of that representation?
I actually don't know the answer to that. It should be the representation. I don't know the representation.
It sort of sounds like that.
It sounds like that.
And then the non-primary ones you get by acting with
the It sounds like that. Yeah. Now, okay, so now let's go to the very briefly talk about what is Thanh's parameter. Probably I will not have time to talk about non-relativistic holography except saying that it is still very sketchy and there is not many results that has been obtained there. Okay, so the question of OPE has been raised. We can postulate that OPE exists. Then what would happen? If we take the OPE of two operator, OX of O1 that is now function of T and X, O2 function of 0 and 0. Principle, one can expect it to be sum over some coefficients that are now generally function of T and X, time operator O3 of 0 and 0, sum over all this operator M. So, the proof of OPE, the validity of OPE has not been given as far as I know. Assume the OPE exists, we can then do a dimensional analysis and say that this coefficient has to be some power of x and delta 1 plus delta 2 minus delta 3. Time of functions, unfortunately for non-relativistic case, the coefficient, the OPE coefficient can be a function of x squared over t. And this has to be computed in general in a theory. If we want to compute, for example, some Green's functions, O1, O2, e to the power I qx, right, dx, dt, dx. In condensed matter physics, these Green's functions are quite important. For example, the dynamic structure functions is the correlation function of two density operator. And if we want to compute that correlation function in the limit of omega goes to infinity and q goes to infinity, or both go to infinity, then the problem simplifies because in the right-hand side, what we will have is a sum of the roughly speaking, 1 over q to increasing power, some number, time a function of omega over q squared, times the expectation value of this local operator. This is an operator statement, so we can apply that if there is an OPE, we can apply it not only to the vacuum, but also to the system with finite density, for example. And there are experiments which are designed now to probe the structure of this unitary Fermi gas at very low, at energy and momentum bigger than the typical energy and momentum of the particle in the system.
So if we are looking at omega and q goes to infinity, we can truncate this series, keeping only the first few terms that are important. And let's think about, for example, what happens if we compute the correlation function psi c temporal phi of x and psi decker at another point, right? Some correlation function that has a zero particle number, so that is expectation value p non-zero, even in the non-superfluid phase. Then all these operators have to have dimension, have to have particle number zero. And what are the lowest dimension operators? The lowest one is the density, psi decker psi, whose dimension is equal to 3. Okay. Next one you can take, for example, psi decker grad psi. But that is a vector. And if the ground state doesn't break rotational symmetry, the expectation value would be zero. The next non-zero term in the OPE would be phi star decker phi. That is an operator with dimension 4, one unit lower than the density. So this is the density that is very well known and can be measured quantity. This is what is called the Thanh parameter. And Shina Thanh, who first figured out that there is a local parameter characterizing the state of the unitary diffusion. Okay. That's the Thanh parameter. Although he, Shina Thanh, reasoning was completely in terms of quantum mechanics. So here we introduce this constant in quantum field theory. So if you... Sorry?
Is this still vacuum?
Expectation value can be taken over all possible initial and final states. Any state. It is an operator statement, the OPE. So then you take the matrix element or the average. Then let me just take...
One question. So is the critical value taken over the primary state or just any state?
Over a physical state that people have in the lab, for example. You prepare a certain state, okay? It is, doesn't even have to be an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. And you measure, do an experiment that measures a certain correlation function in that state. And then you get, you can predict, if you know the OPE coefficient, you can predict that.
Can you say it again, what is this Thanh parameter?
Sorry?
Can you say it again, what is this Thanh parameter?
So at the formal level, it is expectation value of product of phi decker. The operator that has the lowest, the scalar operator that has the next to lowest dimension beside the density, and hence it controls a lot of quantities in the large frequency, large momentum limit.
So you say that number really?
This number depends on the state.
Depends on the state.
Yeah. In the unitarity fermion, that number is P Fermi to the power of 4. And there is a dimensionless coefficient you have to determine. Yes?
I don't understand. There seems to be a degeneracy between the coefficient Cn, which you don't know, and the expectation value of On.
So the C, the On is, typically Cn is can be computed perturbatively. And the reason you can compute perturbatively it is because it is a few body problem. You can derive the OPE by taking matrix element between state with very small number of particles and solve the quantum mechanical problem. Here, now going to the many body state, all these characteristics is parameterized by the expectation value. Okay, so we introduced Thanh contact parameter. Then if we compute, for example, let me show you one of the calculations. For example, I compute the OPE coefficient of this psi decker, the psi decker psi, x is zero, and then Fourier transform, omega q. What we find is that it's equal to, I would just write down the result here and draw the diagrams and contribute to it. And I'm doing calculation in Minkowski space. I'm not completely, and people have not studied completely whether the OPE in Minkowski space in this case is good enough. It makes sense. Assume it makes sense. Okay, so the Green's function of the two particle obtained this contribution from the Thanh's contact parameters. But the diagram actually goes like this. So this phi vector go into the condensate, and then the OPE coefficient is a product of three propagator, which is written there. Very simple calculation. For example, now integrate over the omega, we get NP, the occupation number equal to 1 divided by P to the 4. That is actually the way that Shinatan introduced defined his constant through the tail in the distribution function of the particle at high momentum. So if you look at the N of P as a function of P, you'll see some non-perturbative thing here, but the power law at infinity is completely defined, 1 over P to the 4. And although we have seen that everything in the web, in a quantum field theory point of view, actually this 1 over 4 is nothing but just a Fourier transform of the of two-body density matrix. That is square is 1 over x minus y squared. If you Fourier transform, you can derive that just by looking at the Fourier transform of the wave function. And the singularity of the wave function give you this 1 over. Think so. Although in the BCS limit, there is in the BCS. If the interaction is contact, then you can trust this formula for not only at a equal infinity but at finite a as well. But now we know that this constant characterizes all the the leading behavior of many high energy processes. So if you do a deep inelastic scattering on a cloud of cold atoms, which in condensed matter physics called the Bragg scattering, then you would in principle be able to see also this in the response functions.
Ordinarily if you have CFT with some operator O and some dimension, right? And then you take O with Dagger. You wouldn't generally expect it to be twice the dimension of, but here it seems to be exactly twice.
Yeah, if you draw the diagram that renormalizes the operator and take into account the fact that the time, the propagators are all have four only on one hand, it's all retarded. You can show that the operator of this operator, the dimension of this operator is twice. There is no. If you take, for example, phi time psi, that would be another thing. Phi prime psi would be equal to operator with three particle times something that is singular. The dimension of our operator O3 is the lowest energy state of three particles in harmonic potential, which is determined now completely to be 4.2227 something. Yeah, you can. So this dimension three operator contribute, for example, to the elastic peak of the dynamic structure factor. Outside the peak, this is completely determined by this. It's just there are kinematic problem where this one contribution from this one is completely zero.